All right, everyone, good evening. We want to go ahead and get started because we have a very full agenda this evening. So first of all, thank you so much for joining us for our first West Placer virtual community meeting. I'm Placer County Supervisor Bonnie Gore, and tonight we are going to provide an update on planned construction and development in West Placer County and in West Roseville. We are recording the webinar and it will be available for viewing on my site by next week, March 31st. So here is the agenda for the evening. We will hear about approved development projects in West Placer County, primarily the property south of Baseline Road. Next, an update on current construction happening in that area and how to stay up to date with what's happening. You will hear about some road improvements coming to the West Placer area. We've asked the City of Roseville to give an update on their current and upcoming projects. We'll have an update on future roadways. And finally, we'll have a Q&A, questions that have been submitted by you, our audience. Questions submitted were provided to the presenters to include in their presentations. And other common questions that were submitted will be presented at the end during our Q&A session. And then any questions about specific situations will be directly addressed to residents who submitted them. And one quick note about public comment. We won't be having public comment this evening. Goodness, with the number of residents who have joined us this evening, actually over 1,400 of you. If we gave everyone 3 minutes, we'd be here for several days. So I certainly appreciate the interest. And as always, you can certainly reach out to me personally on any topic. So it's a full presentation. And let's go ahead and get started. So what do we mean when we refer to West Placer? This is a map of Placer County and the area of, and this is the area of Roseville, the area west of Rockland, south of the city of Lincoln, and out west to the Placer County line. The next slide is a close-up of the area. And the portion outlined in black is the city of Roseville. And to the west of that and south of that is unincorporated Placer County. As many of you are newer to the area, you may not be aware of all the planning that has taken place over the past 15 plus years in both the county and the city, and the planning they've been doing for future development. The Placer Vineyard specific plan south of Baseline Road, and that's in the pink, was approved by the Board of Supervisors in 2007. Riolo Vineyard specific plan in the light yellow was approved by the board in 2009. The Sierra Vista specific plan in turquoise was approved by the Roseville City Council in 2010. It is a lot of development. Both the county and the city have worked hard to balance these specific plans to include not only housing, but land zoned for business and commercial, parks and other public amenities. These projects take years to plan before they are approved, anywhere between 5 and 10 plus years. For each of these specific plans, there were numerous public meetings, input was gathered from the community before they were ever approved. And they were actually all approved over a decade ago before I even served on the city council or on the board of supervisors. And now we are seeing a lot of construction out in these areas. Economic conditions drive the development process. And as you are aware, there is a large need for more housing. And the purpose of this evening is to inform you of what is coming to the area and to make sure you know who to contact with the questions that you have. So we'll start with an update about the approved development in unincorporated Placer County. Chris Schmidt is a supervising planner with Planning Services Division and has a degree in urban and regional planning. He worked for the planning division since 2000 and has been involved with the Placer Legacy Program, long range planning and grant writing, and since 2016, current planning. So Chris, we will hand it off to you.
Thank you, Supervisor Gore. It's a pleasure to be here tonight. I will share my screen. Give me a second. So the focus of my talk tonight is the unincorporated area of Western Placer County. And there is quite a bit to talk about. We have a bunch of development projects that either are approved or under construction or are currently under review by county staff. And I'll give you a run through on all that and then some.
Chris, I'm going to make sure your screen is sharing because it's not sharing as of yet.
We'll try it again. Still nothing?
Still nothing. And if that doesn't work, we'll go ahead and share it from our screen.
Okay, I'm told it'll eventually catch up to me. So we'll see. So as you saw earlier, the map, the general area in question is southwestern Placer County, including the city of Roseville. A bunch of specific plans approved by both the county and the city in this area, many of which are either under construction or very close to construction. The Willerga Road, Finneymint Road, north-south arterial is kind of the dividing line between old and new, not only for the city of Roseville, but also for the Dry Creek planning area. So on the east side, you've got Sun City, Roseville, and some other areas along Blue Oaks and Pleasant Grove, and then the new development in West Roseville, including Finneymint Ranch, West Park, Sierra Vista, Sierra West. And then in the Placer County and incorporated area south of Baseline Road, you have Riolo Vineyards and Placer Vineyards specific plans on the west. And on the east side, existing residential development, including established neighborhoods and subdivisions, but also large lot residential. So I would consider Baseline Road and Willerga Road Finneymint intersection as the epicenter of development in West Placer County. If you stand there today and look west, you'll see a bunch of development happening, including the first neighborhoods in Placer Vineyards, Riolo Vineyards to the south, Sierra Vista in the city of Roseville, and the future site of Baseline Marketplace. And we'll talk about each of these projects in coming up. So my focus really is the Dry Creek Community Plan area, which is south of Baseline Road, to the county line to the south, Sacramento County line to the south, a little bit west of Foothills Boulevard in the city of Roseville, to the Sutter County line in the west. So the Dry Creek Community Plan area has seen quite a bit of growth since 1980, adding 1,300 residents, elevating to a population of 5,000 in 2010. That growth continued between 2010 and 2020. When roughly 1,332 residents and 330 new homes were constructed, representing a 20% increase in population. Today, the plan area population is estimated to be a little over 6,300 residents. And as you can see here with total building permits, it's been fairly steady, about 25 to 28 building permits per year. We've had a couple spikes, and those are in relation to subdivisions that came online, including the Vineyards, which is on the south side of Vineyards Road, just west of Foothills Boulevard. Also Hidden Crossing and Morgan Ranch. They built out in 2015, 2016. And that created a spike in the Dry Creek Community Plan area. So far this year, we've had 24 new housing permits in the Community Plan area. So nearly as many as the 30 issued last year. And it's really the tip of the iceberg. And it's gonna increase substantially with the new projects coming online this year and next. So the planning area is predominantly residential. Just 161 acres of the 9,200 acres in the plan area are zoned for commercial. 85% of those acres are within the Placer Vineyard specific plan area. And so here's a look at the development projects either approved or underway or we're reviewing today. one commercial project under construction at Brady and Baseline, one proposed at Willerga Road and Baseline Road, that's the southeast corner, five residential neighborhoods either installing infrastructure or constructing homes at this time, 11 approved subdivisions that haven't started work yet, four residential neighborhoods that the county is currently processing for entitlements, and one improved industrial warehouse facility near the city of Roseville's wastewater treatment plant. So here's the Willerga Road east-west dividing line. On the west side, you've got the Dry Creek or the Placer Vineyard specific plan area, and then the Riolo Vineyard specific plan area. So large master planned developments with hundreds of homes and trails and parks. And then the east, let me go back up. And on the east side of Willerga Road, you have scattered residential neighborhoods, subdivisions, relatively small. So the Placer Vineyard specific plan is the biggest of them all. It's the county's largest specific plan area, totaling 14,000 or 5,200 acres and 14,540 residential units. And that was approved in 2007. And what you see in orange is the first phases of Placer Vineyards. Those will be the first neighborhoods built out. Property 1A is by Lennar Homes, Heritage Placer Vineyards. It's an age-restricted community. Infrastructure work is underway there today. The next two neighborhoods will be 4B and Property 7. So those will be your first three neighborhoods in the Vineyard specific plan area. So if you drive down Baseline Road or Willerga Road today, you won't see much activity, but internal to the site, the roads are nearly all in. Lennar Homes is going to be constructing homes here very shortly. Here's a look at those first neighborhoods, 399 acres, 1,285 units, relatively small lot sizes of 5,000 square feet. So this will be an age-restricted community. Property 4B, 83 acres, 313 units, 6,500 square foot lots, so a little bit bigger than Heritage. Work has not started on this, but the project is approved. Placer Vineyards Property 7, currently under review, 357 acres. The first phase of that is 448 units, and the balance is a little over 1,200 units. Same lot sizes as Property 1, 5,000 square feet, so relatively small. The second specific plan area is Riolo Vineyards. That's on the west side of Willerga Road, north of PFE Road. To the west is Watt Avenue, a significant Dry Creek corridor on the north side of the site with trails and parks. So thoroughly planned for residential and recreational use. 525 acres with 933 units. Home building has been underway along Willerga Road on the first neighborhood for a couple of years now. That's the Mariposa Farms community by Homes by Town. 30 acres, 106 lots. Average lot size is 5,500 square feet. The Glen Willow neighborhood, part of Riolo Vineyards. The infrastructure work is under construction there. That's on the north side of PFE Road. That's in another 177 lots and smaller lot sizes, 5,700 square feet. Mason Trails is the connector between the two neighborhoods currently under construction. Work has not started on Mason Trails. It's 78 acres, 170 lots. And then we have two new neighborhoods in Riolo Vineyards that are currently under review. Silver Sage, another 270 lots. And then the Frisbold subdivision, 116 lots. I'm not gonna talk a lot about regional university specific plan. It's another specific plan area. It's on the west side of Roseville, nearly extending to the county line. That's adjacent to the West Park neighborhoods. Their project's in the pre-development stage. It's 1,100 acres, includes 600 acres set aside for a university. Will include 2,269 residences and another 1,700 university residential units and 24 acres of commercial space. So I'm just gonna go alphabetically through the projects that are in the community plan area. Brady Estates is a small subdivision on the west side of Brady Lane, just south of Baseline. Half acre lot sizes. Brady Self Storage is just north of that project. It's on the corner of Baseline and Brady. That self-storage facility is nearly complete. Brady Vineyards, just south of that, northwest corner of Vineyard Road in Brady Lane, 118 lots. Brookwood Estates is on the south side of PFE Road, another 17 lots, about quarter acre home sites. Cabral Ranch is on Cucurella Road, just south of Vineyard Road. It's on the west side of the street, 12 lots, nearly 1 acre in size. Double S Ranch is across from Cabral Ranch. It's at the southeast corner of Vineyard and Cucurella Road, 36 lots in about half acre parcel sizes. Morgan Creek Residential is 7 lots. They were created near the existing clubhouse. Home construction is currently underway there. Morgan Knowles is at the northeast corner of Willurga and PFE Road, 61 lots. Morgan Place is across the street, southeast corner of Willurga and PFE, 91 lots, relatively small, about 2,750 square feet. Morgan Ranch is on the south side of PFE Road near the Morgan Creek community. Home sales there are nearly complete. I think there's 4 lots left of 103 lots. Saber City Park Estates will add 24 units to the Saber City manufactured home community. Construction there should start later this year. That'll be affordable residential units. The one industrial project recently approved are a pair of warehouses on Booth Road, two 14,400 square foot buildings side by side. The Winding Creek neighborhood is across from Creekview School, 19 lots, 15,200 square feet lot size. The Baseline Commercial Center is at the southeast corner of Baseline and Willurga Roads. It would be the first neighborhood commercial center in the community plan area. 31,200 square feet of retail and service space, including a gas station and 7 buildings. And that project will be at the Planning Commission for review tomorrow, actually. PFE Ranch is another neighborhood that the county is currently processing. It's at the northeast or northwest corner of PFE and Cucurella Road. 10 lots, 27,000 square feet each. And then 2 projects that are in pre-development stage, Creekview Ranch, roughly 650 lots. That's on the north side of PFE Road at the intersection of Antelope Road, and then also across the street at the southeast corner of PFE Road and Antelope Road. So we just got an application in for that, and it's just starting their entitlement process. And then the Morgan Creek project, which would be built on 45 acres of the existing golf course site, 79 total lots, lot sizes on the north side of the creek, 20,000 square feet, and on the south side, 12,000 square feet. So that's also in the pre-application stage. So all totaled, under construction, 675 lots, 14,773 approved residential lots, but unbuilt. We're currently looking at 396 additional lots in 3 different neighborhoods, and 729 lots in the pre-development stage, and then the 3,982 units in the regional university specific plan area for a total of a little over 20,555 lots. So not everything is going to be market rate. The Board of Supervisors recently passed an affordable housing fee. It'll apply to all new residential private development countywide. So the specific plan areas and any developments with more than 100 units have to construct 10% of their units as affordable. And then units or developments between 80 and 100 units are allowed to pay an in-lieu fee. And that's $2 a square foot of livable space. So just a recap of what's coming up. Lennar expects to pull building permits for their 12 model homes at Heritage Placid Vineyards, starting work in April. And then home sales should start sometime this fall. The Glen Willow neighborhood in Riolo Vineyards is gonna start infrastructure work sometime this spring. We also expect 3 neighborhoods and vineyards to begin construction after the infrastructure work is completed in the central area of vineyards. That's property 7, property 4B in the second phase of Heritage. And then 3 neighborhoods in the eastern portion of the community plan starting work this spring. Mason Trails, which is part of it's part of the Riola Vineyard specific plan, Brady Vineyard subdivision, and also Morgan Knowles, which is at the northeast corner of PFE and Willerga. So that's an overview of what the county's been working on for the last 15 or so years and our current projects. And I'll be happy to answer some questions during the panel discussion.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Chris. We really appreciate the update. Next, we have Rebecca Tabor, who will give us an update on current construction projects in the unincorporated areas of West Placer. Rebecca is a Deputy Director of Engineering and Surveying with Placer County. She is a graduate of Cal Poly San Luis Obispo with a degree in Environmental Engineering and is a licensed professional engineer in civil engineering. She has served 20 years with Placer County in land development and an engineering role, and most recently 3.5 years in management. So take it away, Rebecca.
Thank you, Supervisor Gore. After planning approvals, private development projects are required to submit improvement plans to the Engineering and Surveying Division for review and approval. Our division is responsible for inspecting public improvements during the construction phase. Last year, we set up a Western Placer current construction website. Due to the large number of development projects planned to start construction concurrently in this area, in order to help share information on these projects with the community. Underneath the picture, you'll see the URL for our current construction website, www.placer.ca.gov/current-construction. When you enter this into your web browser, next slide, please, you will see the current construction homepage. This is what it looks like. Last year, developers began constructing infrastructure, including sewer and water extensions, roads and sidewalks, to support the creation of over 500 residential lots in this area. This year, development projects are anticipated to start construction to create an additional 1,200 residential lots. On our website here, you can see the current project plans are listed on the right, lower right, and there are links to some of the major projects, and you'll get much more information if you click on these links. Then on the left, there's a Western Placer interactive map. And this is the tool that I encourage you to use to zoom in and get more detailed information on the individual projects. This map shows project shapes. You can zoom in and you'll get the project name, the description, the developer's main contact person, construction status, and links to obtain additional project details. Next slide, please. This is an example of the interactive map when you zoom in and what you might see. This is the Project Vineyards backbone infrastructure kind of highlighted here. It is a $32 million infrastructure project anticipated to start this spring. It includes a 24-inch water transmission main in Baseline Road from Roseville to the west to support the Placer Vineyard Central Group development. It also includes widening a portion of Baseline Road to the south for 4 lanes, and it's a length of almost 3 miles of widening on Baseline. There's 3 new traffic signals proposed along Baseline. They're depicted here with the 3 green dots that you see towards the upper part of the picture. These are at the intersections of Paladay Road and 2 new Placer Vineyard roadways called Wild Poppy Road and Trade Center Road. There's a new sewer lift station depicted by the red dot kind of to the west of your screen. and a new sewer trunk line depicted in the purple line along Dyer Lane. Also, open space drainage improvements are shown in the light green shapes. Expect limited intermittent lane closures on Baseline Road and Palladay Road during the construction timeframes and during off-peak hours. The county and the city of Roseville will work together to coordinate closures on Baseline Road. Next slide, please. This is Placer Vineyards Property 1A, also known as the Heritage Placer Vineyards. And I wanted to bring up this example of an ongoing project. As Chris said, it's a Lennar project. There's Wallerga Road widening anticipated to begin, actually it's undergoing now, widening to four lanes in that red area depicted here on your screen. The orange dot is the location of a new traffic signal at the Town Center Avenue new road connection with Wallerga Road. Underground work is mostly complete in Wallerga Road. The signal poles are expected to go up at the end of April or early May timeframe, and they are targeting paving Wallerga Road in June. Next slide, please. And one more example to share, the Riola Vineyard Glen Willow project. This is depicting what happens when you're in the interactive map and you click on a shape. In this case, the light blue shape is Glen Willow. You'll get a box that pops up and it shows all the project details, and you can expand this and get a better view to read it better. So this Riola Vineyard project is also constructing intersection improvements at PFE Road and Wallerga Road. The orange lines show that intersection work that's ongoing. There's a possible lane closure expected in early April, but it should be minimal and intermittent. And there's a traffic switch or realignment expected in early June at this intersection. They target the construction to be complete in October. For the Glen Willow project, the blue shape here, there's a drainage crossing. You can see the blue line crossing PFE Road. That drainage crossing has to be constructed, and there's a proposed full road closure on PFE Road for about a 3-month period for that construction starting in April. The Department of Public Works will discuss detour information for this proposed closure during the next part of the presentation. Next slide, please. So in closing, we encourage you to visit our current construction website. We've repeated the URL here. Please use this interactive map tool to get current information and find out what's being constructed in your area.
Thank you so much, Rebecca. We really appreciate that construction update. And we are going to go ahead and move on to our next speaker. Stephanie Holloway is a senior civil engineer with Placer County, and she'll provide an update on some current road projects in the area. Stephanie has 20 plus year history with Placer County and currently leads and manages a team of transportation professionals. She and her team work closely with community development on new and redevelopment projects, assisting with technical support to address traffic congestion, safety, as well as long range transportation needs. So take it away, Stephanie.
Great. Thank you, Supervisor Gore, and good evening to everybody on the meeting. As Bonnie mentioned, I'm Stephanie Holloway with the Department of Public Works. Rebecca Tabor outlined some projected development-sponsored roadway upgrades for this summer, Baseline Road, as well as Wallerga at Town Center and at PFE Road. I'm happy to be here tonight to give you some additional detail and information on our county-sponsored work and also approved projects. Our public works team is excited to be finishing up the Wallerga Road Bridge replacement project. The bridge structure is complete, and the photo on the left side of the slide is a current bird's eye view looking south to Sac County. We'll be finishing the final paving starting next week and wrapping up with a few final details before We hope to have this roadway in full operation sometime in May. Next slide. In Rebecca's presentation, you also heard about a full closure of PFE Road between Watt and Wallerga, hatched here in the red. Roadway widening associated with the Riolo Vineyards project, as Chris laid out, and some major drainage upgrade and crossing of a drainage on PFE Road really drove the need for us to consider a full closure. We know that this will be an inconvenience for some, but we're really hoping that by allowing a full closure for a minimum amount of time, that we decrease the time frame for that construction and the inconvenience. So as Rebecca laid out, the road is approved to be closed through our road commissioner, Ken Grimm, from April 19th through July 10th. The detour that you're seeing here is essentially will be set up for drivers to really aid them with out of the way travel. The detour isn't too far. To the north, drivers will be asked to detour up to Baseline Road. That'll serve as our east-west roadway with PFE Road closed. Next slide. And then again to the south into Sacramento County, working to set up some detour to divert drivers to Alberta Road. And we're working closely with Sac County Public Works on this information and this detour. So both roadways, Baseline and Alberta, like I said, they're gonna serve our east-west traffic with that roadway closed. They may see some slight increases in the traffic due to that closure, which again is mid-April to mid-July. Next slide. And I will just briefly mention the possibility of an overlay. Public Works does annual overlay and road resurfacing. We are looking at the potential for resurfacing Baseline Road. This may occur only if we can coordinate with the Placer Vineyards work that Rebecca outlined as part of their backbone for the widening of that roadway from 2 lanes to 4 lanes along the Vineyards property, as well as installation of some additional access traffic signals. But if for some reason that work gets delayed, the county may choose really to hold off until we can coordinate with that widening and schedule that. Really, again, to just try to limit the disruption of the potential for travel delays. Next slide. Lastly, I'd like to end by highlighting the roadway vision and the need to accommodate growth in Western Placer that Chris and the City of Roseville will lay out for you tonight. This slide is really intended to illustrate full build out of the existing roads and new roads in the area. These ultimate improvements will be built in phases, however, really in conjunction with the phases of the planned residential and commercial. There were a number of questions that we received prior to tonight related to accommodation of this additional growth in traffic, as well as people in the area. And as you can see from the map, Baseline Road, Watt, Santucci, Wallerga, Fidiman, and Westbrook in this immediate area really identified for an ultimate 6-lane facility to handle that all those additional units that Chris laid out. Portions of PFE, the new Dyer Lane within Placer Vineyards, Pleasant Grove, among others not on the map tonight, will be widened to accommodate a 4-lane facility. I'll also just briefly mention there are 2 new connections that will be built eventually. From the Placer Vineyards project into Sacramento County, and those are Paladay Road and 16th Street. So again, just giving you kind of a vision and a big picture here for all of the expansion and new roadways in this immediate area. And it really, in the interest of time, I'll just say that the development is really tied to a host of infrastructure expansions, including roadways that really fit the desires of our community plans. So with that, I'll hand it back to you, Bonnie, and thank you, it's a pleasure.
Thank you so much, Stephanie, we appreciate it. Now let's go ahead and take a look at what's happening in the city of Roseville. It is my pleasure to introduce Roseville City Council member Scott Alvord. I had the opportunity to serve with Council Member Alvord for 2 years on the Roseville City Council. Scott represents District 5, the West Roseville area, and he does an excellent job of staying on top of current issues and doing his best to keep his residents informed. So go ahead, Scott, you can go ahead and take it away.
Great. Good evening, and thank you so much, Bonnie, for organizing this meeting based on this attendance. Clearly, everybody's interested in what's happening around them because there's a lot of things going on. So I used to live in the neighborhood near Pleasant Grove and Foothills way back when that was the western edge of populated Roseville. I moved to West Park in 2015, and the cul-de-sac I live on was and still is very close to the new western edge of the city. The expansion's been incredible. As a Western Roseville resident, I'm very aware of the community's concern, our experience, and the growing pains that we all see around us. And I think it surprises a lot of residents, especially those that move here, to hear that Roseville's expansion was decided decades ago, long before Bonnie and I were elected. And we still have in the city roughly 10 to 15 years more of development. And so things are going to change, and it's been planned long before us. And so people need to be aware of that. The other challenge that we have is the developers, not the city, they're required to build, extend, widen roads and bridges as they build the housing and commercial. And sometimes it happens in a patchwork manner, especially in the neighborhoods. And so the desired road connections, and especially the commercial zones, they tend to lag what we need in the neighborhoods. And so that's part of our growing pains. And, apologize for that. I know that the city tries very hard, but it's really hard to tell developers when to go. And I think the staff do a good job trying to balance that out. So I'm going to introduce two highly regarded experts on our city staff. And I know that as a city council member, I rely very heavily on our city experts to provide facts, because I certainly am not an expert in any of this material. Greg Bitter is our planning manager in the Planning Services Department. He manages the planning division for the development services, and he has a master's of arts in urban and regional planning from the University of Florida. Prior to working for Roseville, we actually stole him. He was the principal planner for the city of Sacramento, where he managed the current planning section. And the planning division has kind of two different sections. They have a long range planning section, which is what you'd guess would be a long range type of thing, the general plans, specific plans, coordinating with the local, state, and federal agencies to figure out what's coming. And then there's a current planning section dealing with all the entitlements. When developers or the public have land use, zoning questions, need some help, and code enforcement. Greg's a fantastic individual. I've worked with him many times. He's very good at explaining it, easy to understand language. He's just a really nice guy. He's a great asset for our city. Mike Isom is our development services director. He served our city for over 20 years in various roles. Back in 2018, he was appointed as the development services director, where he oversees planning, land development, engineering, permitting and plan review, and code enforcement activities. He graduated magna cum laude from Chico State University with a degree in geography and planning. He's a certified economic development finance professional. He holds a green belt in Lean Six Sigma methodology, and he's certified as a crime prevention through environmental design specialist. That's kind of neat. And he's also a licensed pilot in his free time, and a wonderful musician as well. He co-authored the city's economic development strategy in 2012. And I first got to know him when I was the president of the Downtown Roseville Merchants, and he led the multi-award winning development of the 316 Vernon Street Annex building. And he helped negotiate a lease with Sierra College. So I just wanted to brag on these guys a little bit. We really rely heavily, and I think Mike is gonna be speaking first.
Thank you, Councilmember Albert. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for the time to present. In Roseville, just like the county in Roseville, we're seeing development activity that we haven't experienced really since the early 2000s, since I started about 20 years ago. Since January of 2020, we've seen about 2,000 new finished lots, or which are home sites that have come online. And by the end of this fiscal year, which is June 30th, we're expecting to have issued just shy of 1,700 permits for new single family home construction. And just by comparison, an average year for us is about 900. So we're almost double what our normal absorption would be in any given year. We're also seeing a significant increase in development of multifamily housing. The majority of these projects are market rate, so the projected rents on a lot of these projects are anywhere from the $2,000 to $3,000 per month range, so quite high. The most recent affordable housing projects we've developed in the city have been in the downtown area, but there will be a few proposed in the western portion of the city in the next few years. These projects will help the city in fulfilling its requirements for providing affordable housing, which is a state mandate. There was a common question that I noticed that was submitted in advance. I just wanted to point out that we're currently processing an application for Mercy Housing to build a 98-unit affordable project on Pleasant Grove Boulevard adjacent to the Eschaton project. The project has stirred quite a bit of interest. We've had several people asking the city not to approve it. Greg is going to talk about the specific plan process in a few more slides, but I think it's important to point out that this site has been designated for high density residential and affordable apartments since 1997 when that particular specific plan was adopted. It is private property and developers have divested or vested development rights, so they do have a right to develop it. Ultimately, this project does help the city implement its state mandated affordable housing requirements. So next slide, please. On the non-residential front, we're seeing what we would typically expect in an average year. So we're right around 500,000 square feet of non-residential or commercial development, about $35 million in valuation, which is a measure of investment in construction activity. All told, our department handled over 9,100 permits and land use entitlements this past year, and we performed north of 33,000 building inspections. I have a staff of 8 inspectors, so that's quite a feat on their part. With respect to commercial development, this is often a question we get. We're typically asked why commercial development isn't happening faster. There's many reasons for that lately. As we all know, if we shop on Amazon or anything online, commercial development's really undergone a lot of changes in the last 15 years. So we've seen the recession happen. We've had changes in lending practices for commercial developers. So it's much harder to obtain financing. And obviously for the past year, we've been dealing with the COVID-19 pandemic, which has decimated a lot of retail industry. So the consequence of that is that brick and mortar tenants are really more risk adverse and they're looking for more certainty and success in their business before investing and taking out loans to open new stores. So that trickles down to the development itself. It makes it more difficult for commercial developers to line up enough tenants in order to qualify for the financing that they need in order to construct those commercial developments. So it's kind of a ripple effect. Really, the commercial developers need a growing population in order to make commercial projects financially feasible. So the residential growth that I described in the previous slide is a positive sign for lenders that are investing in commercial development, and that'll help those commercial developers. So that's a question that we get asked all the time, and I just wanted to try to hit that in a few minutes there. So at this point, I'm going to hand it over to Greg, and he's going to talk about more of the specific plan process of some of the projects we're working on.
Thank you, Mike, and good evening, everybody. We can go to the next slide. I'm going to stay on this slide for a little bit. These are the three areas of the city that I'm going to speak about. The Campus Oaks project, the Creekview and Fitment Ranch Phase 3 area, and then Sierra Vista specific plan. But before I get into each of these areas, I want to explain how the city for the past 35 years has implemented the specific plan and used the specific plan process to control growth and manage growth. So the areas that you see circled in red have all been planned through either the use of a specific plan or a master plan. Specific plans allow the city to plan for and manage all of the anticipated growth that we've projected. The plans take a comprehensive look at growth and they account for the city's needs relative to land use. So the city works to make sure that there's the right balance of residential, commercial, office, and industrial land, as well as parks, open space, and public land for municipal operations like fire stations, water wells, electric substations, recycling facilities, et cetera. The process ensures that the future city services are anticipated and available as the population grows. We often get questions regarding whether or not the city is planning for all of this residential growth. And this growth is planned for early on because the city is what's known as a full service city. We provide all municipal services. We have fire, police, electric, sewer, water, parks and recreation. There's really no special districts that serve the city. So through the city manager's office, we have the ability to coordinate all municipal services. So again, this process ensures that all these services are anticipated and available as the population grows, as I said. And I mentioned fire, police, parks, and libraries. So for instance, the fire department, as we're doing, working on specific plans, they identify locations for future fire stations. These sites are identified and land is set aside to be dedicated. Development occurs so that we have adequate fire station sites. The police department continuously monitors growth and adjusts its patrol beats to make sure that they have the right number of officers serving the right number of population. Parks department, they identify parkland and open space. We identify it and then it's dedicated again as development occurs. We ensure that this is designed so that trails within open spaces are planned and there's all that connectivity that you can see throughout the city is planned. And then parks are developed as neighborhoods grow. Parks are typically developed using, especially in the west portion of town, CFDs. So there's fees for park development and CFDs pay for parks maintenance. So as residential development occurs, the parks department is able to build and maintain parks for the growing population. Utility services are expanded to meet new demands. Water, wastewater, electric, and solid waste services. Their staff understands and monitors growth and they expand those services as development occurs. Another question that's come up quite a bit coming up to this meeting and then just in general with the city is the water supply. There's always a question about, does the city have enough water to meet the demand of all of this growth? And as we go through the specific plan process, developers of each specific plan are required to work with the city to secure an adequate water supply prior to the development commencing. So there is a plan in place. There is a secured water supply for the build out of the city. And the city's Environmental Utilities Department, they continually work to diversify what we call our city's water portfolio. That is done to ensure that there's always going to be an adequate water supply for both for existing development, of course, and new development. This work includes investments through obtaining new water contracts, as well as improving the water supply through the use of aquifer storage and recovery. Mike hit on it a little bit with his example on the Mercy Housing Project, but I think it's important based on some of the questions here and just questions we get in general to emphasize the fact that an adopted specific plan includes a land use map that not only depicts land uses, but includes unit allocations for the various types of residential use, single family, multifamily apartments, commercial uses, anticipates intensity of office, commercial, industrial land through square footage. And sometimes these parcels don't develop for 10, 15, maybe 20 years. For instance, the Mercy Housing site Mike referenced, that site was approved for affordable multifamily housing 24 years ago by city council action. They're now ready to develop the site and they need their design review permit. So the question of whether or not that site was ever identified by the city for affordable multifamily housing, that has been determined 24 years ago by the Roseville City Council. So it has been approved, it has been anticipated since the adoption of these specific plans. And you will notice, one of the main reasons we're doing this presentation or my portion of the presentation that I'm gonna get to is talking about commercial development. It's very typical to see single family residential development occur first and for years. And then you may see an apartment. Industry over the past 15 years. So you start to see those come up, but you have quite a bit of single family development occurs. And then you start seeing vacant land being constructed adjacent to single family. And so those are often controversial situations. So the next slide I'm gonna go to, I'm gonna start getting into what's going on in these areas. And I think a lot of folks will be happy to hear about these particular projects. So can we go to the next slide? So the first project site I'm gonna talk about is the Campus Oaks Master Plan. This was approved in 2015. It used to be a portion of the Hewlett-Packard master plan until the western portion of the Hewlett-Packard master plan area was amended to include residential and commercial uses. So there's approximately 950 residential units split between townhomes, apartments, and single family in the plan area. And then the commercial development is designated for about 240,000 square feet of retail and commercial space. I don't know how many of you have been to the new Nugget market. It's my understanding that it's already very popular and quite busy. In addition to Nugget, there hopefully soon will be a 24-hour fitness, a pet store. And then if you go on the leasing page for the developer, you can see that they're planning on a Starbucks, a Del Taco, Mod Pizza, Jamba Juice. I know lots of people like to hear about who's coming into these sites. Frozen yogurt, dental. And then we're working on a proposal behind the Nugget for a new Ace Hardware in this neighborhood. So that's kind of, I know this is on the eastern side of Western Roseville, but I think this is a new development that a lot of folks are interested in. So we can go to the next slide. This slide depicts the western portion of Fidement Ranch and the what's known as Winding Creek, which is the Creek View specific plan. Again, the yellow, the lots, the single family lots depicted in yellow are under construction. The lots depicted in blue have been approved through the planning process. Fidement Ranch has a total of about 5,900 single family homes total homes approved. And Creekview has a total of about 2,000 homes. And construction has just begun in Creekview. You can see in blue, the Hayden Parkway Bridge was just completed. I think we just had the grand opening a few days ago. And the Blue Oaks Boulevard construction connecting to Westbrook Boulevard is now complete. So you can drive all the way to Westbrook on Blue Oaks and then head south all the way to Pleasant Grove, which provides a lot of connectivity for that neighborhood. So now I'll talk about a couple of commercial projects that we have going on. The Plaza at Blue Oaks, I wish I had a current picture because this site is under construction right now, but this is at the northeast corner of Fidement Road and Blue Oaks Boulevard. It's an 82,000 square foot shopping center. It's anchored by a 35,000 square foot Raley's grocery store. Their gas station's been approved. And several additional pad buildings also that have been approved. I can tell you that right now we're working with the developer on a couple quick service restaurants in the site. If you read the Business Journal, you'll see that Chipotle, Habit Burger have been mentioned, coffee users, salons also. So it's they're having good luck with letters of intent from prospective tenants. So we're hoping that Raley's is open in early 2022 at this site. Also, it's not on the map and I don't have any images of it, but on Fidement Road, just north of this site at Fidement and Angus is a project known as Fidement Plaza. And that is a small gas station with about 10,000 square foot of retail. And I know they want to have some food uses and convenience serving retail uses at that location. And that should be under construction as well this summer, hopefully open again in 2022. So now we can go to the next slide. And this is the Sierra Vista specific plan with one slight annotation is I've circled the Village Center. The Village Center is a parcel of land within the West Roseville specific plan. It's kind of right at the border of Sierra Vista and West Roseville. So I want to report out the development activity at the Village Center. But the Sierra Vista specific plan was approved for about 8,800 new homes. Again, you can see in yellow under construction, blue approved through the planning process. You can also see some of the construction activity. You'll see in green, Westbrook Boulevard that's been complete. You'll see in red, the portion of Baseline Road that's been widened and that's complete. think it was mentioned earlier that baseline will be widened as development occurs along the length of it, as each developer constructs his portion of baseline. I do want to report out, because there's several questions, you can see a gap between Westbrook Boulevard, or on Westbrook Boulevard between Earl Rush and Vista Grande. That is will be constructed in a couple of phases. And right now, I think the outside estimate is 2023, but we're hoping to get it complete as early as next year. Also, you'll see on this map Market Street. That's another north-south street. It's at the right-hand side of that green road that is Earl Rush. The development that's going along there, that street as well could be constructed as early as 2022, which would be another north-south connection all the way from Pleasant Grove to Baseline Road. So those are very important roadway connections. So if we go to the next slide, this is the Village Center commercial site. It is under construction, as you can see in the lower picture. It's a 1,600 square feet of retail space and a restaurant and cafe. The developer of this site is actually the owner operator of the restaurant and cafe in the back corner. They're planning on opening this facility, which is going to be called Kitchen 747. And I'll let you all know that you can go online to kitchen747.com. They have a menu up and have all kinds of information about when they're opening. They're very excited about providing some of the first indoor dining services in Western Roseville. They believe they have a great site next to the Anella Lucan Park. So we're looking forward to this project being open later this fall. So we can go to the next slide, which is the one we get the most interest, most questions. I think a lot of people cannot wait for this to happen. This is the Baseline Marketplace at the corner of Fidiment and Baseline Road. This is almost a 750,000 square foot retail commercial center. It's a large retail serving center that was designated to serve the majority of West Roseville, to be honest. It has three large floor plate commercial buildings, all greater than 130,000 square feet. And typical users that go in buildings this big are Lowe's, Home Depot, Costco, Target, et cetera. There's quite a few fast food restaurant pads, three gas station parcels, 23 outlying restaurant and retail parcel buildings. It's set up to accommodate a bus transfer facility in anticipation of future transit needs. And I can tell you that in talking to the developers, they are actively working with tenants or to try and find tenants. The first thing they need to do is pin down some of the large floor plate tenants, because these tenants having leases signed or letters of intent signed allow the developer to go out and get financing to build the infrastructure. There's approximately $9 million of infrastructure necessary to construct, to begin the construction of this project. So they have an initial $9 million outlay that they need to make in order to get this project going. And so there is active negotiations right now with prospective tenants. They are working very hard to make this happen. And I think the city, this project has been approved through a major project permit process. So the planning entitlements for this project are complete. Once they identify tenants, really all they need is building permits and engineering permits, and they can move forward with this development. So I think the next slide is just the building elevations. And again, it's a little bit old. I know a lot of folks know that this has been in the process for quite a while, but we're hoping that it's sooner than later that we see this development occur. So the last slide is for my presentation is just a slide for the city that you can check out. The website is down at the bottom, www.roseville.ca.us/developmentactivity. It's our current development activity report page, where you can check on current project details, newly submitted projects, and get an idea on our current residential building activity to see how we're growing in Roseville. And until questions, that's all I have for tonight. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Greg and Mike. Really appreciate you taking the time this evening to provide an update of all that's going on in the city of Roseville. Next, we have Mike again, and Mike is the Executive Director of the Placer County Transportation Planning Agency. Mike will provide an update on large transportation projects in West Placer, including Baseline Road and Placer Parkway. Mike has more than 30 years of experience in local government prior to being appointed to PCTPA in 2018. Mike served as the Deputy Director of the Yolo County Transportation District. He has also worked in transportation planning and economic development for the cities of West Sacramento, Placer County, Yolo County, and was the Director of the Port of West Sacramento. Mike and his family have lived in South Placer for the last 25 years. Take it away, Mike.
Thank you. Thank you, Supervisor Gore. And if we could go to the first slide. What I plan to do tonight is really explain a little bit how this fits into regional planning and also how this fits into a couple regional roadways that we have planned for the western part of the county. Before I start, I would say, you know, as Bonnie said, I've been a member of this community for a very long time, lived in Roseville for over 20 years. Our family has been involved in the planning of West Roseville. You heard Greg mention Nelalukin Park, which is in your community. That was actually named after my late wife, who was very involved in the planning for West Roseville. So this is a very important part of the community for me. And I live in West Roseville near the intersection of Pleasant Grove and Wood Creek Oaks. So moving forward, if we could go to the next slide. Our job at PCTPA, and we're a special district, we're not the county, we're not the city, but we're a special district created to plan transportation on a regional level. So for the entire county and for the entire region. And as you know, we have a lot of folks that live in Placer County that work and visit other places in the region. And so not only do we have to plan for Roseville and Placer County, but we also have to plan for the entire, what we call the Northern California mega region. And this is an illustrative slide that shows that a major portion of the workforce in Placer County works in other places in the region. And we have to account for the movement of people back and forth. Next slide. And how we do that and how we plan on a larger scale for transportation is we take all the specific plans that have been talked about tonight, which are part of general plans for the county and for the city of Roseville. And we take all of those as well as the other general plans for the rest of the county, and we put it in, we take the growth projected in there and put it into what's called a regional transportation plan for all of Placer County. That then feeds into another organization you may have heard of called the Sacramento Area Council of Governments. And that's a 6-county planning organization where we plan for growth and transportation and housing for all 6 counties in the Sacramento metropolitan area. Next slide. In the case of all these general plans that we talked about tonight, it is quite a bit of growth. If you add them all together over the next 30 years, you're talking about a lot of new homes, over 70,000 new homes, close to 200,000 people, and close to 32 million square feet of office space. So we as a region plan to grow, you know, 30, 40 years ago, and we're on the pathward to do that, and we need to plan for our roadways, and we have, both regionally and within the cities and within the specific plans in the county. Next slide. I very quickly wanted to mention, you know, we have been greatly affected by the pandemic. We are seeing, and these are just 2 snapshots of slides showing graphics of traffic. We are seeing traffic return very quickly with the pandemic. We are actually at 90% of the level of traffic we had prior to the pandemic, not only on regional roadways, but also within roadways in our communities. Next slide. And that's also pertains to Interstate 80. And a lot of what we do actually is the improvements that you see on those 2 regional roadways to widen Highway 65 from its current configuration to 8 lanes all the way up to Blue Oaks, and then 6 lanes all the way up to Lincoln, and then to widen Interstate 80 and remove those bottlenecks on Interstate 80, which include the interchange itself and a couple other spots on Interstate 80 where you have a neck down in lanes. But we also are planning some other roadways, which I'm going to talk about next, in western Placer County. Next slide. The first one I'm going to talk about is Riego Road, Riego Baseline Road. It was a lot of the speakers tonight talked about how development is going to pay for certain sections of Baseline and Riego Road, but we need to look at that on a more regional scale and work together with our partners, Placer County and City of Roseville, but also bring in Sutter County, because as you know, Baseline Riego Road extends all the way through Sutter County, and Sutter County is planning for growth and development in their area. And so we have to come up with a regional way to connect Baseline and Riego in the gap section where there is no development. And so we're working very hard on that. We've developed a regional fee mechanism for Baseline Road in Placer County. Sutter County is in the process of doing that. And then we are aggressively pursuing grant funding from a number of sources to help fill in the gaps to get that funded so we can initially take Baseline Riego to 4 lanes and then eventually someday to 6 lanes. And I'll go through that a little bit in the coming slides here. So next slide. So we all know where this is located at. Essentially, we're planning from Foothills Boulevard all the way to Highway 99 on Riego Road and taking that again to 4 lanes and then eventually to 6 lanes. Next slide. So the first thing we have to do is plan on how to do this. We have to do what's called a project study report. And that project study report was just completed and adopted by our board. And it takes a look at widening Riego Road and what are all the constraints to do that? And there are many. There are things like a Union Pacific Railroad crossing in Sutter County. There are stop signs that need to be transformed to fully signalized intersections. There are other things that we need to accommodate that affect the cost and the progression of making this project come to fruition. Next slide. We have to take a look at all modes of travel, primarily automobile in this case, but we have to look at all the other multimodal elements such as future bus service or future bike trails and that type of thing for the entire extent. Next slide. Again, this just kind of outlines all of the stakeholders that were involved. And one thing to mention with us, we did not do this in a vacuum without the development community because they are driving a lot of the need for this. And so we've worked very closely with the builders along this area in both the county and the city of Roseville to get their input on how to time and how to come up with a mechanism that will actually be supported and built over time. Next slide. So we took a look at two alternatives. One is strictly a road widening project, initially going to 4 lanes and then someday till 6. So we have to kind of plan for the future of 6 while we're trying to build 4. And then we also took a look at a method of looking at a multi-use pathway along Baseline Boulevard, Baseline Road and Riego Road. So not only just highway, not only just automobile serving, but also multimodal serving, so that people that want to commute, and there is industrial and employment services along this corridor, but they could also use another mode to get there as well. And that's important for two aspects. One is we want to look at how to get people out of their automobiles as much as we can. But also when we take a look at how we compete for grant funds, the state of California is moving to a method where they want to see us combine projects that include bike trails and other multimodal elements to that. And so we took a look at an alternative to that, which has a separated bike path or multi-use path along the extent as well. Next slide. Here is a roadway cross section showing both of those alternatives where you have just the roadway section on top and the alternative two with the multi-use pathway. Next slide. So this the cost of this, it is very costly. It's anywhere between $122 and $136 million. And a breakdown of how much that would cost and an eventual conversion to 6 lanes. But although this is a lot of money by any shape of the imagination, the good news is we have cooperation between the two counties. We're working very closely together to make this happen. And we very shortly will have a regional fee mechanism to pay for a lion's share of this. So this is not a project that it's, you know, someday we're going to build and someday we're going to, you know, get a lot of money. We have a mechanism in place to actually build this project in a reasonable amount of time with a little bit of grant money that we'll have to go after. Next slide. So the next steps, we did what's called a project study report. We then have to do preliminary engineering. We have to do an environmental document to look at the impacts of construction of this roadway. We then have to move into final design, look at things like right-of-way and permitting and that, and then eventually construct that roadway, hopefully within the next, 5 to 7 years. Next slide. The other roadway that was mentioned in some of the questions and answers before the meeting and during the meeting was about Placer Parkway. We have accelerated the construction of Baseline Road because it is needed today. Placer Parkway is something that the county approved as a whole, not just Placer County, but Placer and Roseville and our board. The alignment for this new 8-lane expressway that goes all the way from Whitney Ranch Parkway near Rockland. If you've noticed that unfinished interchange, they're going to finish that interchange and then take that expressway. It's not a freeway, but it's a limited access expressway that looks like a freeway all the way from there, all the way over to Highway 99. And the way this is designed to build, it is primarily developer funded, but it will be built in increments because it is developer funded. And so it will be built from the east to the west. But because this is going to take some time to build, that is why we accelerated Baseline Road's upgrade to 4 and then eventually 6 lanes. Next slide. We are happy to report, though, that this has begun going. Although this is a $600 million roadway, again, a lot of money over time, we are very happy to report that Placer County, along with their partners with United Auburn Indian Community, are looking at the construction of the first phase of that, which will take the roadway from Highway 65 all the way over to Foothills Boulevard, where it will initially connect into the city of Roseville via Foothills Boulevard. This project is in final design and permitting. It's in the right-of-way phase, if you will, and we're hoping that this project will go to construction in 2023 and be done in 2025. And then the next phase of it will be built, and then the next phase and so on, and eventually get you over to Highway 99 at Sankey Road. That concludes my presentation, and I'm sure you have a lot of questions, and hopefully we'll be able to answer it in the next section on Q&A.
Thank you so much, Mike. We really appreciate it. And speaking of question and answer, we're going to move into that now. As I mentioned, we took questions that were submitted and we have staff available to answer some of these questions. In addition to our panelists, we have representatives from both the city and the county. So first off, we are going to start with Council Member Scott Albert. And that question is, a lot of folks want to know about what businesses are coming to Roseville and when. So Councilmember Albert, what can you share with us?
It's a tough question to answer because a lot of times the property owners are working on contracts. And so I can repeat a few things on the Blue Oaks Plaza, which is at Fitiment and Blue Oaks, the northeast corner. And this, a lot of this came out of the Sacramento Business Journal. And I did talk to the developer and they confirmed that yes, they are in discussions with some of these, but some of these are still like letters of intent, so it could change. But they're talking about having up in that area an AutoZone, a gas station, Great Quips, Nail Breeze, some kind of a coffee thing. I've never heard of it before, so I'm still not quite clear on that one. And the Garden of Eden is and also Habit Burger and a drive-through Habit Burger and drive-through Chipotle, besides the Raley's up there, the big grocery store. We just had the coffee shack approved. We don't know, and this was just west of the Fitiment Pleasant Grove intersection. And we don't know the name of it yet. It just got approved. They rezoned it. For a drive-through coffee. So I don't know if it's a Starbucks, Dutch Bros, whatever. They haven't contracted with anybody yet. And they were saying they weren't expecting to even start construction until next year. So likely something like 2023 before it even opens. The other thing is I can mention at the Baseline Marketplace, I appreciate that the comments that the staff said, that they are in negotiation and they they do have a pretty big store that's very interested, but they don't want to be the pioneer. So they're trying to land at least one more big store before they announce anything. And I do know, and I can confirm that they're definitely very active trying to get that. They've been working on that. A lot of us on the west side, that's just a huge thing, and that'll help alleviate a lot of traffic. You think that answered most of it on the west side, Bonnie?
I think so. I know there's lots of interest, and the good thing is that there's actually plans and things in the works. So I know it's hard to be patient, but they are coming, and we appreciate you giving us some insight, Scott.
Something else real quick is if anybody knows somebody that is wanting to expand a business, a lot of these property owners are looking for contracts and leases. They've got extra room, especially the ones that have started building. There's usually still other pads that are available. So if somebody wants to franchise, branch out, please get a hold of these property owners. I know they would love to get some of those business. And they'd have a monopoly. 45,000 people with no competition for a few years is a pretty good deal.
Absolutely. Great. Thank you so much, Scott. So we've received a lot of questions about roads in Roseville, and to address those questions is Shaikowski. He is the Director of Public Works for the city. So Jason, why don't you go ahead and answer some of these questions about ways the city of Roseville plans to address some of the traffic adjacent to the feeder and older parts of town.
Sure, thanks, Bonnie. So there's really two ways that we address traffic issues in Roseville. One is through operations, and the other is through construction. So let me talk a little bit about operations first. So, we have a lot of traffic signals in the city of Roseville. They control the flow of traffic. And the way we manage movement of traffic through Roseville is through updating the timing of all of our traffic signals every 3 years. We take a look at the latest volume information, see where people are going, and update the green times to try to minimize the total delay at the intersection. If the intersection is not part of a coordinated corridor where the lights are synchronized to hit green after green, we try to minimize the delay of that standalone intersection. A lot of our major corridors are coordinated or synchronized. And what we do at those locations is we try to balance minimizing the total amount of time people have to stop versus the amount of times a car going down the main corridor has to stop at different lights. And we update that every 3 years as well. So that's one way we handle traffic increases in the city. The other way with operations is we have an intelligent transportation system. Basically, all of our traffic signals and other traffic equipment are connected through fiber optic cables. We know how many cars are on the road 24 hours a day, 7 days a week in each lane. And we can modify that timing. We can monitor the timing or the operation of the roadways with traffic monitoring cameras. We have our changeable message signs to let you know what's going on. We can update in real time the signal timing. Let's say there's an accident or some major event is going on, like shopping during Christmas. We can make changes on the fly to our signals to try to keep vehicles moving. So that's operations. But a lot of what we have to do is we have to do construction. So the city, when we are developing new specific plans, we have something called a traffic model. The traffic model basically looks at what the volumes of the city are going to be at some point in the future at build out. And with that, we can determine what kind of improvements need to be made to our roadways. This is called a capital improvement program. Some of those improvements are made by developers right from the beginning, if we know that the traffic's going to be instant at that moment. But a lot of that stuff is delayed and they pay traffic mitigation fees. So our capital improvement program has a list of 473 improvement projects valued at about $484 million. And that is what we will use to build the improvements we need to move traffic throughout the city. So some of the current projects that we are working on in the city to try to help keep traffic flowing smoothly. I talked about these last week at our city council meeting, but I'm gonna share them with you real quick. We worked with Caltrans on the Eureka I-80 westbound on-ramp. We were having a lot of cars back up over there, so that's gonna help cars get onto I-80 a little smoother. We're actually next week turning on a new traffic signal for not only cars, but to help pedestrians and bicycles at Westbrook and Octave Payson. We've got Roseville Parkway Extension. So we're gonna extend Roseville Parkway where it ends currently at Washington and carry it over the railroad tracks. And you'll be able to get all the way through Foothill up to Blue Oaks. That construction project is supposed to start this fall. We're doing some work on Washington Boulevard to do some widening of that roadway through some traffic signals to try to make it more efficient, as well as provide a multi-use path connection so people have other means to get through that area besides vehicles. We've got a roundabout we're putting in at All America City Boulevard on Washington, which is basically the south east corner of the Placer County Fairgrounds. We're starting work on widening Roseville, the design for widening Roseville Parkway next to the Galleria Mall. We've done all the coordination we can through there. That's a very busy corridor. We're gonna add a lane in each direction through that area, which should help alleviate some of the congestion, as well as add a third left turn lane. If you're coming down Pleasant Grove from Highway 65 and wanna turn towards the mall or the fountains, there'll be a third left turn lane there. We're looking at widening Pleasant Grove Boulevard in between Washington, Pleasant Grove, Foothill and Wood Creek Oaks. So it'll be three lanes in each direction. That project's going to start design this year too. Construction's a couple years out. It takes a while to design these projects, but they are in the works. And that's just some of the near-term projects we have going on. You can go to our website, roseville.ca.us/PW for Public Works, and you can take a look at some of the projects going on and see what's coming down the road for improving traffic. So, development, a lot of times I hear people talk about development not, paying for the improvements we need because of their impact. Development does pay for the improvements. Sometimes it's a little delayed because, no one development is responsible for a single improvement. Let's say for Roseville Parkway Extension, there's a lot of development that's occurred that's responsible for paying for that improvement. And we have to wait for enough of that development to occur that's responsible to have enough money to build the improvement. So sometimes our improvements are a little delayed, but we are working on it as quickly as we can get the funding together to keep everything moving smoothly in the city. And if you have more questions about this, you feel free to reach out to me. You can find my email address on the website. I'm the Public Works Director for the City of Roseville. Send me an email, give me a call, and I'd be glad to talk to you about it more.
Thank you so much, Jason. We really appreciate it. I do have a question about parks. We're going to talk about parks, but before we do that, I'm going to go back to Council Member Alvord. We did mention that there have been questions about a postal annex in the west side of Roseville, as well as a Trader Joe's. Scott, do you have any insight? I know everyone would love to have a Trader Joe's, but any insight that you've got that you can share with everyone this evening?
Well, the postal annex is tricky. I know, it's a federal government service and they move as fast as molasses. It's they're aware that there's a big demand for it. They know there's a big population. Regional local postmaster actually lives in Western Roseville. And when I had talked with him a couple of years ago, he had stated that he knows that there's a need on the west side and they're looking into it. I have no idea what that means. I don't really have an update, but there are franchises like mailboxes, et cetera. And I think the UPS store, there's things that you can actually franchise. Somebody wants to start a business on the west side, you'll have a huge captive audience. Trader Joe's, I swear every single, it feels like every person who bought a house in Western Roseville was told by their realtor that there's going to be a Trader Joe's right over there. It's kind of a joke almost because there's so many claims about that. And so here's the thing on Trader Joe's. So Roseville, I've done a lot of research on this as not a council member, but in another thing here. And Roseville actually would be an eligible city for a second Trader Joe's. We actually have more characteristics than many cities, and a few even have three Trader Joe's. So we would be eligible for it. Trader Joe's protects their placement team heavily. It's hard to get a hold of them directly. There's a website where you can fill out a thing, and it kind of doesn't help right now. What really has to happen is we have to have a developer make a special proposal for Trader Joe's. Give them a really good deal because they want to go in where it's very affordable for them. And so I know I've talked to several developers that have big lots out here. They're interested. And one of the ideas is if they're able to come up with something, again, they have to get some other anchor tenants to kind of help cover some of the development process. So if they find an opportunity to give a good deal to Trader Joe's, then we have a mechanism. It's a Facebook page. It has a couple thousand members on it of Bring Trader Joe's to Western Roseville. And this is not a city thing, but we're offering it to any developer. If they're ready, we can ask all of the residents to go fill out that form and give a website where they can get a hold of the developer. So we're not ready yet. A developer hasn't been ready. So it kind of comes down to, you know, we'd love to put one, but we can't make anybody give them a good deal. And so we'll see. It's, you know, it's a long shot no matter how we do it. And, you know, my family would love to have a Trader Joe's here too. But it's just definitely a long shot. And currently there's no plan. So.
Well, thank you. We appreciate the update. I know inquiring minds want to know. Let's go ahead to the next question, and that's about parks in the county. Andy Fisher is the director of parks for Placer County, and he's been with the county for 18 years, overseeing all the different parks and trails in the area. Andy, what will the parks and trails look like in the area, and will the trails interconnect with the other trail systems?
Good evening, Supervisor, and good questions. Anticipating some of these questions, I did hopefully have a couple of graphics to put up. And I wanted to answer first by zooming outward to the big picture and then zoom inward to the Roseville area and the existing parks that are there. This is a photo, if you can see it, or a map of the regional trail network that we studied as part of our park and trail master plan that we're just about to bring out to the public again in a new draft with some edits and finalize it. This shows the regional trails that we're looking at throughout all of Placer County. You have heard from Mike Lucan tonight with Placer County Transportation Planning Agency, and his staff and his agency deals primarily, not perfectly, but primarily with trails adjacent to roadways. And we look primarily at trails off of the roadway and kind of the more wild and open space areas. But we do talk to one another to make sure that those connect. So as you look at these trails coming in the future, the black lines, solid lines are existing trails, dotted lines are future trails. Green lines are dirt trails and black lines are paved trails. So you see just to the south and the west part of the county, you have the existing American River Bikeway that goes from Sacramento to Folsom Lake. So we're working in our community of Granite Bay to get that across the community of Granite Bay. The city of Roseville has done great work in getting segments across their jurisdiction. And then in West Placer, along Dry Creek, we built portions through Morgan Creek, you'll know. If you live there between Cook Riolo and Willerga Road, the bridge just made separated grade crossings, so you no longer have to cross Willerga Road to get underneath Willerga at the Dry Creek crossing. The new bridge did some great clover leaf design. And then the developments west of there, Riolo Vineyards and Placer Vineyards that Chris Schmidt talked about earlier, they will be building their segments of trail to connect all the way to Sacramento County at Gibson Ranch. So that will then, with the work Sacramento County's doing, will ultimately take the American River Bike Trail and make that into a complete Sacramento metropolitan regional loop trail that we're very excited about. And then the other segments I wanted to point out on this map is that going to the north and west of the Dry Creek area, you'll hear from Greg McKenzie in a few minutes about the Placer County Conservation Plan, the preservation of acreage in West Placer, high habitat value acreage, high farming value acreage. And so we've anticipated that through some of that open space, through willing sellers and willing buyers and folks who are amenable, that we'd like to be able to give people the opportunity also to get out of the urbanized south and into some of those open space areas with trails that connect up to some of the watershed areas to the west, the American or the Auburn Ravine watershed, the Raccoon Creek watershed. So those are the major loops and the major trail systems throughout the county that this community of West Placer will connect to. So let's zoom in a little bit on the next slide. And here you see the planning efforts in these major developments, some of which have already happened. You can see again the same nomenclature, dashed lines for planned trails, solid lines for trails that are already there. You can see the portions along Dry Creek that are already there. Placer County does own open space already along Dry Creek, about 200 acres worth. And then with the coming of Placer Vineyards and Riolo Vineyards, we'll also include about another 1,000 acres of open space with these trails through that open space network, open to the public, funded through these developments as they come forward, and working with adjacent jurisdictions to make as much connectivity as we possibly can. We'll zoom down a little bit further. There's also questions about parks, what comes with development. This is the largest development, again, is Placer Vineyards. And so you see the green spaces there, the olive green or the open spaces, almost 900 acres worth, with trails going through those open spaces. And then the other green colors are the parks that would be scattered throughout the development. NP stands for Neighborhood Park. And then a couple of new larger community parks. And with those community parks will come some amenities like a recreation center, a joint use pool with the high school, joint use gymnasiums with the middle school. So a lot of the opportunity for folks to have urban level recreation within the new developments that are coming. And those will be open to the public, not just the folks within those developments. There's also the Board of Supervisors and the Local Agency Formation Commission just recently finalized a brand new agency in West Placer. The Placer Vineyards Park and Recreation District will be a self-governing agency that oversees parks and recreation and landscape within the West Placer area. So the boundary of the district right now is the same boundary as Placer Vineyards. So it will begin by just serving the Placer Vineyards development. That could expand over time. It will take effect and become an agency July 1st of this year. The Board of Supervisors will be its initial board, but the intent is that once there's a representative population out in West Placer, that they'd be able to elect their own self-governing board to be self-determining in how parks and recreation work in West Placer. So go on to the next slide. Just wanted to touch on some of what's already there. This is Dry Creek Community Park off Valerga Road, currently in Placer County's inventory. And you can see the portion that's already built colored in there, and opportunity for another phase of development. We are almost fully funded to fund the next phase. We've been collecting development fees from that area and saving those. So we have the opportunity to put in more fields. You'll see on the upper left-hand corner, the writing is small, but the intention there is for additional parking, both for automobiles and for equestrian trailers, because in addition to the paved trail to Gibson Ranch, there would also be an adjacent dirt equestrian trail that would go all the way to Gibson Ranch from here as well. So we'll be engaging the community in the next year or two and begin the planning for this. It's really kind of wide open. We want to hear what the community wants as far as new amenities, what's going to be used the highest and best. And we're also looking at opportunities for parking over off Cook Riolo Road for trail access. So the trail that runs along there is very popular. You can see that Class 1 Dry Creek Trail in the upper right-hand corner of this photo. It's the one that connects over to Cook Riolo Road and into the city of Roseville. That'll be part of that regional loop trail we just talked about. So people want access points to that. We're looking for suitable locations for people to park and get on. And so that's going to be happening in the next year. I think I can turn that back over to you, Supervisor, if there's any other questions.
Thank you very much, Andy. We appreciate it. Let's go ahead and move on to the topic of future universities in Placer County. We have Michelle Kingsbury. She is a principal management analyst for the county. Michelle, can you tell us about the new Sac State Extension campus and other university projects that are planned?
Sure, absolutely. Good evening, and thank you, Supervisor Gore. Hopefully everybody can hear me. My name is Michelle Kingsbury. I am an analyst with the Placer County Community Development Resource Agency.
I'm going to interrupt you really quickly and maybe turn down your volume a bit because you're echoing a lot. Thanks.
Give me one second.
That's a lot better.
Okay, let's. My video is not coming up, but I'll go ahead and speak to keep the presentation moving forward. And if we can go to the next slide, Landon, I'd appreciate that. So we do get a lot of questions about the planned universities in Placer County. We are excited that we do have two specific plans that have been approved in Placer County that have university components, and I'll speak to both about both of those. We do have the Placer Ranch specific plan, which was approved by our Board of Supervisors in the end of 2019. So it's our newest specific plan that was approved. And this plan is located west of Highway 65 near the Thunder Valley Casino and Resort and adjacent to the city of Roseville. And one of the cornerstones of that specific plan is a plan 300-acre site for a Sacramento State satellite campus. The specific plan analyzed the capacity for that campus of up to 30,000 students. However, we do expect development of that Sac State Placer Center to proceed forward over time and not reach that capacity for many years to come. The Sac State Placer Center is planned and includes a very unique partnership with Sierra College to have a Sierra College transfer center on site, which does allow for the opportunity for a student to seamlessly transfer from Sierra College to Sacramento State without changing the campus, so that we'd have that transfer center located on the Sac State satellite campus site. Next slide, please. In terms of status of the development of the Sacramento State satellite campus, the property owner for Placer Ranch has entered into a gift agreement to donate the 300 acres to the university, and the county and the property owner have entered into separate MOUs with the university. And those MOUs outline our roles and obligations toward the development of that satellite campus. Currently, Sacramento State has a number of committees going on that a lot of us participate on and working on their campus master plan for that site. They have hired a firm called Sasaki, which is an architecture and planning firm with vast campus master planning experience to facilitate that process. The master planning effort is underway for several months in, and it'll take approximately 12 to 18 months from start to finish to complete. The EIR and CEQA process that will need to be processed will be underway in the coming months as well, and could take as long as 18 months or shorter. It just really depends on the comments we receive, that Sacramento State receives through that process and any mitigation measures that need to be coordinated. It is important to note when folks ask about the status of the campus planning that the Placer Ranch Pacific Plan owner is working as well, seeking their state and federal permits to proceed forward and coordinating with the county on the planning of backbone infrastructure. Although we don't have a specific date as to when that satellite campus will be up and running, we are working expeditiously and in a coordinated effort with that property owner and Sacramento State to move that campus forward. And if you can move to the next slide, that would be great too. And as Chris Schmidt mentioned earlier in his presentation, we do have a second specific plan in the Dry Creek Community Area, Regional University Specific Plan, that has a planned university site as well. And that university site, the capacity that we analyze is for a university of up to 6,000 students. And the property owner, similar to Placer Ranch, is working through his due diligence efforts for a university partnership on site. And again, although we don't have specific dates for the opening of that campus either, we do work quite a bit with the property owner and are committed to working to keep that project moving steadfastly forward and bringing these universities to the region. So that is the update I have. And of course, if anybody has questions, don't hesitate to reach out to me directly. I'm happy to answer any questions that the community may have regarding the status of those projects.
Thank you, Michelle. With all this development, there are concerns about how the county preserves open space and protects local habitat. We've asked Greg McKenzie, he's the Conservation Program Administrator for Placer County, to address these issues. Greg?
So good evening, Supervisor Gore. Hopefully you can hear me okay. This is actually a preview of an update that we're planning to give to the Board of Supervisors scheduled for April. As it relates to Placer County specifically, the Placer Legacy Program is a countywide open space program initiated by the Board of Supervisors in 1988 to implement the goals, policies, and programs of the county's general plan. The program is designed to work in partnership with other interest groups and stakeholders, and we've had great partnerships with the Trust for Public Lands,
Wildlife Conservation Board for the state of California and Placer Land Trust to preserve and protect open space, agriculture, cultural resources, habitat, and wetlands through the recently adopted Placer County Conservation Program that I'll talk about briefly in a moment, as well as recreation opportunities. In the past 20 years, this program from the county's side has put in over roughly $32 million into open space and agricultural acquisitions, conservation easements, ag easements, mandarin growers, and other similar agricultural interests, grazing lands in and around the city of Auburn. And so the upside of that contribution from the county has been, we've actually been able to leverage almost another $50 million from other partners, Trust for Public Lands, Wildlife Conservation Board, other entities to help bring more open space to West Placer. Now, Placer Legacy is a countywide program, but it has resulted in roughly 3,700 acres of open space and agricultural conservation. It's important to note that those funds and those lands are in addition to other wetland and habitat mitigation requirements you get through development projects. So with that, I'll move over to the Placer County Conservation Program. And I can talk about this for an hour and just scratch the surface. But very quickly, as it relates to vernal pools and species, as well as ag and open space, the county, the city of Lincoln, Placer County Water Agency, and South Placer Regional Transportation Authority, which is an arm of Mike's PCTPA organization, recently adopted the Placer County Conservation Program. And we recently received final permits from the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, National Marine Fisheries Service, California Department of Fish and Wildlife, and Central Valley Regional Water Quality Control Board. So without getting too far into the weeds, the program recognizes that all this growth you've heard about this evening, it's going to occur, it's likely to occur given economic dynamics currently, and it will result in impacts. But the program, the PCP program, now requires mitigation for those impacts to occur in Placer County. It's important to note that prior to the PCP, that mitigation for impacts occurring in Placer County could occur elsewhere in Sacramento County, Yuba County, Colusa County. So the PCP requires all mitigation to occur in West Placer where the growth is occurring so that we don't experience all the growth and none of the mitigation to offset those effects. It does one more important thing. Not only does it require mitigation for open space, vernal pools, sensitive species and habitat, but it also requires a commitment to conservation above and beyond mitigation. So not only are you seeing the mitigation occur in Placer County, it requires conservation, and that will come through additional funding through the state and federal government and other nonprofit organizations that we'll partner with over the term of the permit, which is for the next 50 years. It has a total reserve system, preserve system of 47,300 acres over the next 50 years. So with that, I'll turn it back over to Supervisor Gore.
Thank you, Greg. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Now, we've had some questions about services planned in the unincorporated areas of the county. Michelle, what will police, fire, and other services look like in these newly developed areas?
So thank you, Supervisor Gore. And great question. I think as we've all learned through this presentation tonight is that development planning for these large areas is very comprehensive, and we look at all facets, including how to fund services and public facilities needed to serve these areas. And I'll speak specifically just to the unincorporated county and what we've got planned out there. In West Placer, the county has planned and established funding structures to raise revenues for both building construction and to fund the operation costs for many of these public facilities and services either mentioned already, such as parks, or mentioned throughout this presentation, like police and fire, et cetera. And revenue structures are typically dependent upon the construction of housing units, which drive the majority of the revenues that we receive. Funding structures like capital facility fees, due at building permit issuance have been set up. to fund buildings. While we, I think Greg mentioned in his presentation, it's very commonplace now to establish and set up community facilities districts or CFDs, and those provide the revenues to support the enhanced service levels. So some of the new facilities we do have planned in West Placer, in addition to those already mentioned, such as the parks, to support those increased populations include a 15,000 square foot regional library that will be located in the Placer Vineyards Town Center. In addition, we have planned for a sheriff's substation in this area to serve the needs of the residential population. We do have three new fire stations planned as well. Two within the Placer Vineyards specific plan, and you can see on this map, we tried to star them, one off the Watt Avenue area and another off Paladay. And then we have a third new fire station planned in the regional university specific plan. And that would bring with these three new stations plus our existing station, the Dry Creek Fire Station, a total of four stations that would serve the needs of this area. In addition, we've got we've got funding set up and a program in place to support the construction of a transit center. And that would be located in the Placer Vineyard specific plan as well. And we've set up structures to support increased transit operations and things like that that would be paid for by these development communities. And again, it's very comprehensive. We look at both when these developments come in the early stages and when they're getting ready to build and setting up these funding structures to ensure we have sufficient revenues. But as mentioned with a lot of the presentations, well, there's a bit of a lag time as we look for these revenues to come in as housing construction happens. And over time, we save that money and we plan for these facilities and to expand those services as the revenues come in. So thank you.
And before you leave, there's one last question that people always want to know about when it comes to development, and that is, where is all the water coming from to support this development?
It's a great question. So for the unincorporated county, Placer County is not a water provider. We work closely with the Placer County Water Agency, or PCWA, who's either the what we call the wholesaler, where they provide or sell the water to others. And we also work with CalAM, California American Water Company, who has a franchise agreement in the Dry Creek Community Plan area. But most of the water that supports these developments planned in the county is provided by PCWA. And through that entitlement process, as I mentioned, very comprehensive, our staff and we work with these water agencies to review all their master plans to provide water, how they're planning to provide the infrastructure for the delivery of the water to these developments. So it's a very comprehensive process. We do at the county have a general plan requirement, which is that we're a surface water primary water source, that we require these developments, similar to what Greg and Mike have mentioned, to show where they're getting their water from in the early stages of the development. And we work with PCWA, and PCWA has their urban water management plan, and they update that every 5 years to evidence what the demand is for the water and what the supplies are that they have to meet those demands. And it looks at both short-term and long-term. And PCWA has a myriad of water sources that they have rights to, which include rights to the North Fork American River, as well as its tributaries, and including their water storage and its Middle Fork project. And so there's plenty of planned water supply through PCWA, as well as planned infrastructure to get that water to these developments. And I would encourage folks, if they really want to dive down into the details, PCWA on their website does have their latest urban water management plan, which does have provide all the details regarding demand, both short-term and long-term, as well as the supplies and where those come from.
Thank you, Michelle. That was very, very helpful. So I know we've provided you all with a lot of content this evening, and we really appreciate you joining us. As I mentioned, the recording of this presentation will be available on my county website, placer.ca.gov/Bonnie Gore. And we want to thank all of our panelists for sharing with us this evening, and thank you all for joining us. There have been a lot of questions in the Q&A, and we've been trying to answer those as we're able to do so, but we may not have gotten to everyone, and we may not have had all the content experts on the line. So as we close, here are the contact emails and phone numbers. If you have any questions about any of the projects or plans presented this evening, you can reach out either to the county or the city staff on the different projects you're interested in. We will leave the screen up for the next 10 minutes to give you time to jot down any of the information that you would like. And as always, you are welcome to email me directly with any questions at supervisorgore@placer.ca.gov. So thank you again for joining us. I hope that this information was helpful. There is a lot happening, but there's also a lot of resources that you can reach out to get answers to questions that you have. So thanks so much, and I look forward to hopefully seeing you in person soon. Have a good evening.